My name is Headley Bennett. What they call me Deadly Headley. That's my musical name. Well, I was born in Kings.
Right. Now, if you could start talking to Steve.
Yeah. Headley, tell us how you first got into music.
Well, I used to go to Alpha Boys School. That's run by the Roman Catholic nuns and priests. And at the age of 5, I used to go around listening to the band. But when I went to the bandmaster, he told me that I was too young to get in the band. Well, I used to go around still, you know, like carrying an instrument for the older boys and holding the music stand and such forth. And when I reached the age of 12, I went back. And they gave me an IQ test, you know, like you have to reach like grade 5 before you could enter the band. And I passed it. So I was being inducted into the classic band, Alpha Boys School. Well, I started out on the clarinet. And first year I was doing very well. But I run into a lot of misfortune because I break a lot of instruments, you know, like I used to play a lot and wasn't serious enough until when they suspend me. And then after they suspend me, they gave me another chance, another trial, and that's the time I really got serious in the music. Well, I'm still left Alpha at the age of 16 years old and go out on my own, go back to my parents, you know, start over a new life. And I was doing photography for about 2 years. And then I got back into the music full time. Well, I started playing in road bands, professional. And my first road band was with a Alpha boy like myself in Tony Brown. We all were schoolmates and we decided to get a band together by the name of Tony Brown and his orchestra. And I did a couple years with Tony and I started doing a little freelancing and all. And I met Sonny Bradshaw and I used to do some rehearsal with him. But like nothing wasn't happening. I was on the waiting list until I met one of my schoolmates, used to play in Eric Dean band. That band was the number one band for Jamaica in those times. That is in the 50s. And from my 8th Eric Dean band, I never turned back again. Good music all the way through until this day. Well, in Eric band I used to do like a lot of hotels, gigs, you know. But I had a friend named Lester Sterling. When I came back from Montego Bay, he told me that the music changed. They were having a new music by the name of the ska. So I got to learn it, or else I would go on to play hotel music. You know, like, you know, he said that it was good to create. And I really love that word when he said to create your own music. It was a challenge. And I came right back in Kingston and started to go around with Rico. Rico. Yeah, Rico was a good guy. He used to be the man of the day. And I get a lot of experience from him. It was when Rico was migrating to London that I got introduced to Coxon, to Pseudo One. I was doing a session with counters and the drums. And Cox's son, brother, sorry, named Blackie, a tailor, he called me around the bar and he said that Cox would like to talk to me. And he asked me, we are learning music, I tell him Alpha. He asked me if I know Dan Drummond. I said, yes. And he said, well, if you are from Alpha, that means you have some music in you. And he invited me to Federal Records, that is Paul Corey. And the first track I did for Coxon was a tune named Independence. That year we got Independence. and I team up with Lester Sterling. That was the man of the day. And we had a, like a kind of solo. You know, it was a kind of solo work, like. And from my 81st solo, I got the job with Coxie. Well, I'd like to say a little before Coxie time, you know. Like, I used to do some recording with Jude Creed before I meet Coxie, you know. But I never do much for Jude Creed. It's when I hit Soda One, that's the time I really start to get, you know, like, get serious and you get involved. Well, I have to talk something about Beverly Record. You know, like, when I used to freelancing, it was between Beverly, Jew Creed, King Edwards, and some other small producers. And it was good, because, like, I tell you, I did, first instrumental I did, original, was by Jew Creed, the tune named Joyride. And he never, I don't know if he put out any of those music on 45, but I think they do some dub plates, you know? And I never really lucky to see one of those tunes, much as hear it. From I did that record, I never am hear it again. But somebody told me that it is around, you know? I don't know. But like, after I leave Jew Creed, and I was with Beverly too. That's where I met Bob Marley and Jimmy Cliff. So like, I was between Beverly and Coxie. But like, I used to do freelance work until Coxie decided to employ me, like, you know, weekly now. Then I had to make up my mind and get involved, because I couldn't be working with Coxie at the same time I had been working with other people, you know, it couldn't work out. And I did really glad to be working with Coxie, because right there I get to concentrate and, you know, get to know where I'm going musically, you know. Well, I don't know if you know, but I did Bob Marley first recording, Judge Not, for Beverly's. And also Derek Morgan, Housewife Choice.
Tell us about the Bob Marley session, because that's a very important session.
Well,
can you remember the day?
No, it's very hard to remember. You know? Tell you, because Beverly had someone artists around him. Like you saw Desmond Decker, Jimmy Cliff, Jimmy James, Horn Prince Miller, Wayne Gray, you know, so in those days Bob Marley wasn't even being, they didn't pay much mind. The man of the day was Derek Morgan and Desmond Decker in the Beverly stable, you know. Those guys used to carry the flag, man. Jimmy Cliff, Desmond Decker, and Derek Morgan, they used to carry the flag, you know. I mean, Bob just come in behind, you know. It's when Bob go over now to Coxie at Soda One, then it changed. Like, you know, the next set of younger stars come in and start to split now. They were called the, what you call it? I have a name for it. It was Beverly in front, and then Coxie come in and start to recruit some younger players. And then that's where you got more variety in the music.
Prince Buster, what about, he was also around at that time?
Yeah, but Prince Buster was around with Derek Morgan, Monty Morris. But Prince Buster wasn't as strong as Jimmy Cliff and Derek Morgan and Monty Morris, you know. He used to really put up a good fight, you know. But he wasn't him strong as alternates, to be frank. But in those days, you call it the rude boy time. He was one of the rude boys of Orange Street, you know. And he was really the lead man in the rude boy posse then. Let's call it that, Jamaica language. But if you're going to talk about music, you'd have to put Derek Morgan and Jimmy Cliff. You know? Derek Morgan was one of the most, how to call, progressive hit makers in Jamaica at the time. It wasn't really no more hits than Alton Ellis. Still Alton used to do a good job. But Derek was a man, you know. Everybody did have to follow Derek. He was ahead. He was in front. Everybody coming behind. Till when Derek fade on and then Bob pick up a little. But Bob never really gets strong until in the late 70s, you know. I'm telling you. You know, Bob used to do well, I mean, just in the ghetto community, Trenchtown, a little. You know? It's when Bob went away to London and came back, you know, in the 70s, pick up afresh, and then him start to really punch, you know. But he's a good composer, you know, a good songwriter. But it was kind of rough in those days. You couldn't really go between Derek and Jimmy and Desmond Decker, you know. It was really tight, man. I have Monte Morrison the next and again with a little bumpy dumpy and some little one tune, you know, like stinging. And Prince Buster again with Wash Wash and they all used to gang Bob, man. I'm telling you. You know, it's when they fear don't know. Bob come up. That's it.
After, I mean, you, with Leslie Kong now, you blew some famous solos.
Sure.
For example, the solo on Forward March, yeah, which caused Prince Buster to accuse Derek Morgan.
That's right.
Could you tell us that story?
Well, I used to work for, Sterling used to work for Prince Buster, and I used to work for Beverly, you know, and Beverly used to manage Derek. So, in those days, we got to really put out with a competition, you know. And I look at it that way, that if I'm in a man camp, I'm going to put out my best, you know. So that's the real, that's it really work, you know. And I wasn't partial, you know. And Leslie Kong used to treat me very good, you know. He was a nice guy, you know. And I used to be very comfortable working with Leslie Kong. And that's why you really get so much nice music. You have to be comfortable to really, you know, play good music. It wasn't a lot of money, but his money was more sure than Prince Buster money, you know. And he had a restaurant there, so, you know, if you're hungry, you could go and eat a dinner. And from a belly full, you know, you're going to play. So that's what really good.
So you decided to copy the Lester Sterling or do a takeoff on the Lester Sterling?
Yeah, because okay. Lester was really...
Problem. Lester was... Alright, we're going to start here.
Yeah.
On the Lester Sterling solo?
Sure. Because Lester was a man who really have the original message, you know. I mean, when it comes to playing the instrument, he is really creative. You know, Lester guys used to play like the American style saxophone guys. Lester is the guy that used to have his own style, you know. He never really imitate nobody. And I really did like that challenge, you know. I mean, I couldn't really did play his style, but I create. It give me some kind of idea, you know. Like if he play threes, I might play fours. And sometimes I play threes, but it's overplayed, like in Forward March, you know. I play some triplets in the intro, you know. And let's play some triplets in the Black Eyed Chinaman thing there, you know. Prince Buster style, but it's near. It's near.
So that was a kind of war of the Hounds men?
That's right.
If you could say that.
Yeah, man.
Could you say that for us, that it was a war between hornsmen?
Yes, it was really a war between the horns players in those days. Because you have to fight for your territory, you know, like, if you were soft, you wouldn't eat no food, you know? Serious, man. You have to be tough, you know? That's why when I played the tune, I'm the toughest of Peter Touch, you know? That was one of my way of getting back to the horns guys in Jamaica, you know? You know the toughest?
Yeah.
That's me.
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah, man. I got to strike it to the head, you know? Come on.
So, working sessions now for Coxon. After that's up, you weren't working sessions, you stopped working for Leslie Kong?
Yeah, because I did my group. I used to rearrange them and give us ideas, and sometimes I find my own ideas, like solo works. And him, some of the on rips them, like high fashion, you know, and things coming up to bump, you know, and stars. Connell Campbell. I am the man who created all of those lines. I did a lot of horn arrangement for Cox. You know. Because sometimes the musician run out of idea. And they call on me, you know. So I am really glad for those occasions. You know. So I put out what I have in me, you know. And I don't get no credit for those things, I'm telling you the truth. I've been working for Cox, he never put my name on a record yet. Him the great, full up. I don't know if you heard about it. I am the man that really did the melody in full up, you know, saxophone melody. And my name, and up to this date, is not on the record. But I re-recorded it over on keep my Peace Pipe album that, you know, that is out here, you know. I want to leave that copy with it. So, sure, you know. But I used to call those, in those days, I used to call it my apprenticeship, you know, like, you know, you come from Alpha and you learn to read music, classical background, and then you come on the road and then you have to learn again to play pop music. And then you go to the studio now and then you have to learn again how to blow in the mic and re-recording. So I call it a learned period, you know, experience in Cox, you know. So him doing never put my name on a record, I'm not angry at him. Truly, I'm not angry at him. Sometimes I feel a little way down, you know, because I mean, I get to learn how that you could get some kind of dividend for your work, like some kind of royalty and thing, but I never know about those things in those days. So I just make it go like that, and I give myself no worries.
Yeah. Well, this film is going to go some way to showing people what really went on.
Yeah, man. And you know, people talking about Skia, who found Skia and that, you know, but you know, you have to give a man like Rico and Easy Snapping, you know, a lot of credit. Other people come in and they chip in their own ideas. But the main man, some of the main man, I won't say the main man, Rico, Theophilus Beckford, the late Clark Johnson, you know, this is Samuel Ismay. Aubrey Adams, the late Aubrey Adams, keyboard, right? And there was a guy named Richards, Joe Richards, used to play guitar. And even Jack Jerry, because he was from Beverly days. You have to give him some credit too. Chris Buster do a little, but I don't know. He was a part of it, to be frank. Because you know? They used to call him Boof, Boop. That is the one drop that, you know. He is the man that when you go to the studio, he must take his hand and go like this. Poof. Poof. But it's really the one drop that, I mean, Bob Marley say, feel it in the one drop. That's the one drop that we all are enjoying today and playing in reggae music. Prince Buster is the man who really create that poof. Poof, they used to call him Boop. You know? Boop, they used to call him. So, I mean, I couldn't tell you what era come into it. You know, I couldn't say he was one of the pioneers. But for the time he came in it, he created that one drop there, man. You know? It was, remember in the scar days, you know, you had the blue beat, the beat was like this, boop, 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 boop. You know, but when he start recording, wash, wash and all those two, you know, him say want the drum, he want the drum to boof, he must tell John Baker that, give me the boof, man, give me the boof. And they start to call him on the corner, boop, 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 you know. Because them several times, they used to talk about boop, 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 boop. But it was the one drop that everybody riding on today. Serious, man, you know. I wouldn't really say Prince Buster is the founder of ska. I wouldn't say that. Because him wasn't before Cluet, him wasn't before Easy Snapping, you know, and all those Juke session, man, Arbor Adams. Him used to work with Juke, lift up Box and Cox, you know, him was like a kind of disc jockey. But when he really came into it, he created that scene, man, you know, it's like him come with a raw ghetto music, you know, the boof. Everybody else used to copy rhythm and blues, you know, from the American side, you know. Cox used to go down farm work and coming back with those records, you know, and he used to make the singer them copy it and we all have to try and play like the American style. But the only thing is that the rhythm they change, you know. No, I should tell you about a little about Dan Drummond's. No?
Yeah, definitely.
Dan Drummond's was with Rico, you know. Rico were before Dan Drummond's. And they used to team up together, do a cappella. Well, when Dan came in, I would say Dan helped to he was one of the creator, but he wasn't real the he wasn't with Cluet and those guys, and he snapped in, you know. When he came on, the ska music was in progress already. But he contributed. He was one of the foremost composers and arrangers in ska music. Dan Drummond's. I think you could call him the Godfather. You know, he was a good creator, man. Because he was a man who was responsible for the scatterlight, you know. The scatterlight formed around Dan Drummond's. And Roland Alfonso. Roland Alfonso was around too, with Easy Snapping, I forget to tell you about him. You know, I couldn't really leave out a man like that. But Dan Drummond's was one of the modern creators of ska music in this country. He was in before Bob Marley. Yeah.
Right, so moving up now to the 70s time with Sly and Robbie.
Yeah.
You played quite a significant part there at Channel One with
well,
all the
that's horn shots. The era came in from Canada. Yeah. And I met a producer named Ozzy. Ozzy used to play piano with Roland Alfonso and the Soul Brothers. At the time we used to play at a place named Orange Bowl and Orange Street. That's why I met Ozzy. So when I came from Canada, they all used to come to Canada and look for me. Lee Perry, Ozzy Bonnie Lee. So when I came back home to Jamaica, I wasn't really new to them. So everybody rushing me now, like I used to do a lot for Bonnie Lee. I did some work for Ozzy. I did some work for Big Youth, you know, Big Youth, the DJ. Yellow Man. But with Sly and Robbie now, like I met them at Channel One through Ozzy. And Joe Kim, what them call him, Joe was to call him. And really I started doing some work with them. And Joe give him some rhythm to do an album for himself. And it was me, Sterling, Keith Sterling, and keyboard, Robbie, Sly. Scully were there too. And I was doing some tracks. And I remember I sustained a note, you know, for about 2 minutes, you know, a little longer. And Scully shout out and say that note is deadly. And they call me Deadly from there, Zion, Robbie and Sticky. Say, boy, this guy is deadly, man. His name is Deadly from now. That's how it goes. There's a note as a steal, you know. And Scully hear it and shout out. And Sticky running and Zion, Robbie were there and everybody was feel good, you know. And just give me the name. I said, well, from today, your name is Deadly. Those sounds are very deadly. And they put me on the album. Well, tell you the truth, up to now I don't get one of those albums yet. I don't know who have it. And I'd really like to get all of one, you know. That I can get some royalty from it. Don't know where to get one. I'm not trying to discriminate no one, you know, but it's just the truth. I'd really like to get one of those albums, you know.
Well, in those times, you played in a lot of producers' bands. I mean, you played for the Revolutionaries, for JoJo, yeah. And there were others as well.
Yeah, and some of those songs that I did, I don't hear them again. You know, so much I don't know what they name. I don't even know not what one of the track them on the album name, because I don't see it, I don't hear it. You know? I don't know if it sounds fair to you, you know?
No.
Huh?
No, it doesn't.
But you know, sometimes too, I just don't like to worry about nothing, you know. Because when you worry, you don't win. You know, you only get up the next morning and you say, I have to agree your name. And you can't sleep at night, so you can't eat. I don't really want to be in that position in life. You know, seriously. You know. Sometimes I feel down, you know, very downhearted. But when I'm downhearted, you know what I do? I go home and I lock up all the windows in the house and lock off the light and what? Put myself to sleep. And the next morning I forget everything. Brand new again. And sometimes I take up this. When I take up this, I start blowing up, I forget everything. Everything that is bad. You know? Some people look at me and say, I don't care, you know. It's not that I don't care, I care. But I don't put a lot on my head, you know. If it's not important, I don't try to let it get the whole of me, I can't, you know.
Well, perhaps you'd like to give us a little piece now.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, guys. Yeah. Hope you excuse my grandma, you know. You know, to clean it up. Okay. Yeah, this is the introduction for Forward March that I did for Derek Morgan. You like it again?
Yeah, one more time.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. What about a little piece of full up then?
Yeah, sure.
All right, I'm gonna fill this up.
Are you ready?
Ready. Rick, sorry, Rick. Are you ready, Rick?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Can't pick the best out of that.
What's one of your, what's one of your favourite, one of your own personal favourite songs of all the songs that you've blown for, over the years? I mean, things like River to the Bank, I know you did that for Ozzy. Or a scar that you did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Scar tune,
yeah.
A scar tune?
Yeah.
It's Sound and Pressure at name.
Right.
I did it from in the Suda one for Coxon. That is the first instrumental I did in for Suda one.
Thank you.
I'm the man that introduced Sparrow Martin to the drums.
Yeah. Just one more question. When you were studying at Alpha,
yeah,
what was it like? Was it hard to learn?
No. I don't know, because I used to, before I go in the Alpha band, it was there with a grammar 4 days ago. And I was in the small section. I got Alpha at the age of 4 or 5, you know. And then when I complete 5, because my father died when he was around 25, and my mother had me when she's around 16, 17, she had to stop going to school, you know. And what really happened, when I went to Alpha, we used to have a gramophone in the small section, boys. Then I used to mix the 12-year-old. You know, with the 14, you know, like the 5-year-old to the 10 used to sleep in separate directions, you know, teaching, you know. And I used to sleep signing this gramophone every night when I go, I put my ears in this gramophone and, you know, start to listen to a lot, Nat King Cole record. And then I used to do a little tap dancing and thing, you know. You know, those days in my time was more to tap dancing. So I was really being motivated from very early. And then my mother used to come and we used to go to garden party and she used to dance with me. I never forget that. My mother used to teach me to dance. You know, you can imagine that. So I was being motivated from very early. And then now the next side up, I used to have a family that my grandpeople, them used to in the communal business, you know, they call it, with Pokemon and this. Them used to lick the drums and go out something, but I never did like it because I grew up in a Roman Catholic and it was a clash, you know. You know, them never really teach me about that at Alpha, you know. Them is more tell about, more like about Roman. So I did really, that doctrine wasn't me, you know. So I never too much, I wasn't against the Pocominan style, you know. I wasn't against it. But I never grew in it. But through my family, I had to accept them for what they are, you know. So when I really check it out, the roots were already in me already. Because I used to, when I was playing big band, I used to lick the tambourine, you know, I like the tambourine, I used to shake the tambourine. And go around and lick the drums, you know, the conga drums and things. And then I end up singing one tune in every band that I used to work in. From Irkdean come right up, I used to sing Calypso. Even in Canada, I used to sing every band I play, and I sing one tune, and they want me to sing that one tune every night. They have a tune name, Back to Back, Belly to Belly, or What a Jumba Jamboree. I used to sing that in Irkdean band and in the North Coast, and I used to get money in my saxophone bill. Nobody in the band ever used to get tip, you know. I used to get tip and shirt with the band member, about 10 of us. And to me, it come like what a joke, you know, because every night when I sing this tune, everybody laughing, you know. And sometimes I get shy, you know. So I leave my saxophone, go to this mic and I sing, Back to back, belly to belly, I don't care a damn, I done dead already. Back to back, belly to belly, what a jumbo jamboree. Yeah, man. Then I end up again, singing Monte Morris tune, Money Can't Buy What? Life. I can't remember it well now, but I used to. One time I could sing it, go there. Sing it, don't run over the hotel, not posting. But I quite remember this back to back, belly to belly, because when I sing it, the piano player used to bust out a laugh, you know, the man used to jump up and get excited, you know. I used to get frightened, but I get frightened now, everybody laugh, you know. I'm not a singer, but I, you know, I used to love it, you know. I used to see the rest of Calypso man them playing in the hotel, and you know, the thing getting me is, man, so I get to like it. But it was a great experience, you know. I enjoy every minute of it, man. Every bit of it I enjoy. I don't have no regret as a musician, man. I mean, I don't make no money off it. I make to survive like heat and, you know, but I don't make money like the DJs. I don't make money like him, some of the singers. But as a hand man, you know, it's a little more stiffer, you know. But I don't give up hopes, you know, because I still have life in my body, you know. So I don't feel one day I'm going to get a payoff, you know. But I don't have no complaint.
Yeah.